Good afternoon. As we start the last lecture in the series, I will complete the optics section I was doing yesterday. But before I do that, as usual, I will take up some of the problems, questions which came up in the last during the last lecture. It turns out that even though I was talking about optics, most of the questions which came yesterday were from superconductivity, and of course I will not be able to spend that much of time on superconductivity. So what I will do is all those superconductivity questions will be answered on the forum, and I will only take up today the questions related to only optics, that is the portion which I did yesterday. So let me pick up the questions which came yesterday. The first question I pick up is from 1263 Techno Salt Lake. Kolkata. The question is came from a statement that I made yesterday, that optics people like to differentiate between irradiance and intensity. So the question was, what is the difference between irradiance and intensity? It is a matter of actually definition, the way the optics community uses the word. As I told you yesterday, that I define the pointing vector as E cross H, and the average pointing vector is because it is the average of the sine square or the cosine square term is E 0 cross H cross. Now this direction of the pointing vector is along the direction of propagation. So this then becomes the magnitude of the pointing vector is along the direction of k. So I times k, I think yesterday I wrote k by k, that is not correct. The irradiance is basically the magnitude of the pointing vector, namely half E 0 H 0. Now if you look at write it down in terms of the electric field alone, then it happens to be n by 2 z. Z, if you remember, is the square root of mu over epsilon 0, which is the impedance of the free space. So this times E 0 square. And since the interpretation of the pointing vector is the amount of energy falling per unit area per unit time, so this is roughly the irradiance. The magnitude of that. The pointing vector talks about direction of flow, but irradiance is just the magnitude. So what is intensity? Intensity is very closely related thing, excepting that what the optics people like to do is to talk about supposing you have a source and talk about a solid angle around that source and find out that supposing I take a unit solid angle. I take a unit solid angle and look at any unit area therein. Remember that solid angle does not define how much area you are enclosing, because it depends upon what is the total distance from the source. I am assuming a point source. So therefore, this intensity which the optics people sometimes indicate like this is power per unit solid angle per unit area. So basically, if I take a point source and if the radiation is perpendicular to the surface, then I know that the solid angle around it is 4 pi, and hence what I have is this quantity is nothing but I divided by 4 pi. So that would be my I. So it is a matter of definition, nothing great in it, and as I said, very often we use these interchangeably. Second question says that we know how to, this question came from 1305 Kavi Kulguru Institute of Technology at Ramtech. The question was that how do you analyze a circularly polarized light? We all know how to check for a linearly polarized light, because I take another linear polarizer, and if I put rotate it around it, then of course there will be a position at which no light will come out, which is why it is the second polarizer is sometimes called an analyzer. So the question is that how do I determine whether the a polarizer given to me has had this, either circular or elliptical. The point is that you do it exactly the way you made it. If you recall, the way we made a circularly polarized polarizer is to say that I take two mutually perpendicular direction and have it at same amplitude. Usually the same amplitude is simply obtained by starting with linear polarizer whose axis is aligned at 40, start with unpolarized light and have a polarizer whose axis is aligned at 45 degrees to the x axis, let us say, so that the component of x and y for this linear polarizer is the same. And after that you pass it through quarter wave plate, which has the ability, because it has two different refractive indices for the two directions. So you pass it and measure it in such a way that it introduces exactly a phase difference of pi by 2. And if you do that, then of course you will get a circularly polarized light. Now you could do exactly the same thing in this case, because you see, if you just had linear polarization or unpolarized light, a calcite crystal with a quarter wave plate made out of a calcite crystal will not have any effect on a linearly polarized light or an unpolarized light. On the other hand, if I have to pass through a circularly polarized light is to pass through it, then of course it will be affected. There are many interesting ways people have suggested in order to check for circularly polarized light. One of them is that hold the polarizer close to your eyes and look at the reflection of your eyes on a mirror, and you will find that if you rotate it, you might find no light, and that is because that the reflected light and the incident light at the surface must satisfy the electric field due to incident, and the reflected light must be equal and opposite, and because of the phase differences that is there, it turns out to be dark, but that is just a test. There is one question which I will take up a little more in detail, but there is a question, or rather inquiry, from 1158 NIT Durgapur. So NIT Durgapur has pointed out that this is known as the year of light. As you know that the United Nations had declared 2015 as a year of light, and he says that he would like to know what sort of researches are going on in light in this country. Well, obviously, I will not be in a position to tell you all about it in next 2 minutes, but we have had many major centers of research in optics. Some of them are, for example, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, Bombay, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, the Center for Advanced Technology at Indore, and lots of other IITs and things like that. In fact, there would be, in case you people can find out, shortly an issue of special issue of Physics News, which is the journal of the Indian Physics Association, which will have articles only on light and celebrating the year of light. But yes, a lot of research goes on in that. The last question which I take up is from Vishwakarma Institute of Technology, Pune. The question is that they want little more clarification on what is evanescent wave, what is its use. I talked about it when somebody asked a question, but let me repeat it again. See, what we said is, supposing you have a medium, doesn't matter what medium you take, because it's not necessary that evanescent wave have to be talked into in connection only with optical fiber. But let us suppose I have a refractive index n which is greater than the outside refractive index. This is I am having a reflection, the refraction from a medium with a within this n. So that suppose I have this incident at an angle theta, and such that this angle theta is greater than sine inverse of 1 over n, because that is the refractive index of the other medium. Then what we showed is that this is totally reflected. Now it is totally reflected, but if you looked at all our formulae that we derived, we said that supposing you take this plane, the surface plane, to be the xz plane, then if you look at the electric field just outside the surface, it does not oscillate, but what happens is that I get a profile of this type. We will get a profile which is like this. You have seen this picture in damped harmonic wave, and it sort of goes as e to the power minus alpha y. Y is the distance from the surface. This is known as an evanescent wave. So in other words, it says though the total energy is completely reflected into the medium in which the reflection took place, in the other medium, in this case air in my example, the certain amount of field leaks through, and that field, as you go away from the surface, it quickly exponentially decays away. And typically the field can be found and measured within about 2 or 3 wavelengths of light, and so therefore this is known as an evanescent wave. That is the wave which exists in the other medium even when the total internal reflection took place. Now yesterday in that question session, I pointed out that people ask what good it is. There are many uses of that, but in connection with the optical communication which we are talking about, the point is that suppose I put a let us suppose this is an optical fiber. Remember the way the optical fiber works. I have a core here and I have a cladding here, and I of course have total internal reflections here, and then in this region I have an evanescent wave. Now so therefore if I can bring a sensor very close to it, I can pick up that wave. Now supposing the original light wave is actually carrying some information in the nature of there is a time variation. So that time variation is still there, because what is important is the space variation goes as e to the power minus alpha y. But if the original ray of light or the wave had some variation with respect to time, the same profile with respect to time is even in this case there. So in other words, if any information was coded in your original transmission, that same information happens to be there even when you pick it up from the evanescent wave. And that is why this has quite a bit of a use as a coupler in fiber optic transmission, because when a fiber optics is going around from let us say one city to another city and you want the same information to be picked up, you can tap it by using a coupler. Okay, with that we complete the questions that came up there, and I will now go over to the slides for today. So today my primary interest will be to look at light as for communication. And yesterday we had just about started talking about what is coherence when we ran out of time, but I would like you to be reminded, and in fact it is important that you all understand little more clearly than is written in the book, of the idea of a coherence and why it is important. Because you cannot have interference of light if the beams are not coherent. In fact, that is primarily the reason why we pick up in double slit experiment, the divide the same source, so that I have a division of the you know, the same wavefront I pick up the light source. So the coherence is a fixed phase relationship between the you know, phase up wave in a radiation of single frequencies. Let me explain this with a little clarity. Now suppose I am talking about two beams of light. Then if I can somehow or other arrange such that as time proceeds, then the phase difference that is there between the two waves remains constant. Of course, you would say that this cannot happen. Well, it may not happen for all types of waves, but on the other hand, as I told you, that we can arrange it such that the phase relationship is independent of time. Now, let me give you an example of what happens. Supposing you take a thermal source. Now, thermal source is where the light is emitted by essentially by heating up a thing. So what happens is, in these thermal sources, you excite an electron, and as the electron falls back to the ground state, it emits a light. But you see, the problem of thermal sources that the typical lifetime of the electron in the excited state is about 10 to the power minus 8 seconds or so. Now, so what that lifetime means is that if you are taking a thermal source, that thermal source is giving different light and different waves in every 10 to the power minus 8 seconds. So in other words, that if you wait for 10 to the power minus 8 seconds, you are likely to pick up another wave. And if you pick up another wave, these two waves are not phase correlated. And so since I said 10 to the power minus 8 seconds, it is the typical lifetime of a thermal source. What it means is, if you multiply it by the velocity of light in vacuum, which is 3 into 10 to the power 8, it tells me that the distance over which the phase correlation remains is just about 3 meters. So if you are looking at a wave which on the face of it looks like a single wave, but actually speaking you are having you know, one wave after another. So if you have waited for a distance more than 3 meters, you are not going to get a phase correlation. And as we made a comment in the beginning, the stable interference patterns are formed only when the radiation emitted by coherent sources, usually we split a single beam into two or more beams, as we do in Young's double slit or grating events. Now, in case of actual experiment of two or more light, the amplitude and phase, they can vary in a random fashion, and the instantaneous flux at a given point will fluctuate randomly. And as we have said, that irradiance is defined as a time average. So therefore, if I am looking at a situation like this, remember that this was the intensity expression, and I told you that intensity irradiance expression, and we said that this is what it is. Now what we are interested in is in a time average, because, and the reason is that why I am looking for a time average is that the speed with which light is moving is very fast, of course, one of the fastest that we know. And supposing I am doing it with visible light, I am depending on the persistence of my eye to look at it, or even electronic instrument. So therefore, the impression that is left there is for a fixed time. And so as a result, what you will see is an average thing, and hence I am interested in the averaging procedure. So this is what we have. We take, suppose E1 and E2 arise from a common source. Then what we do there is that I have a source here, it goes by path, you know, I'm normally in a Young's double slit experiment, you arrange such that this path and that path are the same to the two slits. You don't have to do it. You have a path 1 and you have path 2, it goes to slit S1, and you are looking at an interference pattern at a point P. So this thing, this one has gone through this path, path 1, this is the distance it has traveled, path 2 is this. Now if I am to look at such a situation, then the time taken by the path 1, let us say, looks a little bigger. So it's a slightly more time than time taken by path 2 because the distance is a little longer. One defines what is known as a mutual coherence function by the time average value of E1t and E2t plus tau, because it is that if I am observing at a particular time, what I am looking for is something which came from the source. If it is on this thing, you know, if this took a time t, this has taken a time t plus tau. So I am looking for the correlation between an electric field in one of the paths at time t in the other path at time t plus tau. And this is, and if you make, supposing it is the same path that is, I went directly from S1, S to P, then I can define the same thing, excepting that I have to replace 1 with 2, so that I find out whether there is a self-coherence or not. Now, so I said that suppose I have a source which emits normally, though I would like to have a completely monochromatic wave. A monochromatic wave is one which gives you precisely a single wavelength. But of course, most of the waves that we have, they have certain amount of width. And suppose I have a source which emits wavelength at lambda and lambda plus delta lambda. Then if I look at the phase difference after I have traveled some distance L at a time t. Now, then the phase difference between the two waves, my original source had, let us say, component 2 waves. This is nothing but k1 minus k2 L. This is the phase difference. K1 and k2 are the wave numbers. And so therefore, the difference is 2 pi by lambda minus 2 pi by lambda plus delta. Now, I have to sort of decide or give you a criterion of when can I say that the waves are not considered coherent. And well, the optics people have picked up an arbitrary thing. We say that, look, if the phase difference is greater than 1 radian, then don't, the waves are unlikely to be coherent. So therefore, this is the thing. And so this thing, L, is lambda square by 2 pi delta lambda. That is your, the coherence length. That is the length over which the a particular source remains coherent, right? And correspondingly, if that is your coherence length, lambda square by 2 pi delta lambda, very often people take it as just lambda square by delta lambda, it does not matter because these are all estimates. And if you look at the time, then what you need is to divide it by, so this is your L, and you can write it in terms of the frequency or the angular frequency if you like by writing, multiplying and dividing by this thing. You know, I mean, if you had nu by d nu and differentiated it, you will get lambda square by delta lambda. So that turns out to be c by delta omega, which is a 2 pi difference from delta nu. And so therefore, your the coherence time, which is simply L divided by c, is given by 1 over delta nu or 1 over delta omega if you want to include that factor of 2 pi. So this is called coherence time. That is the time over which a source can be considered to have maintained a phase relationship. I have taken an example. As an example, consider, supposing you are taking a 500 nanometer wavelength, which is in the visible spectrum. And take, for example, sodium light, which is 5893 and average, but it has a spread of about 6 nanometer, 5890 to 5896. But for calculational ease, take a wavelength of about 0.1 nanometer width in a wavelength of 500 nanometer. Now, so how much is the coherence length? So we approximately is this 500 nanometer square divided by this 0.1 nanometer, which is, I have ignored that factor of 2 pi. So this is about 5000 wavelengths, which is nothing but 2 millimeter. Now notice what it says. 2 millimeter is not all that big a distance. So it says that if you are taking a wave like that, which has a wavelength of 500 nanometer, but has a spread of 0.1 nanometer, and if you are looking at the interference pattern at a such that their path difference is more than 2 millimeter, then the visibility of interference fringes will be small for such path differences. And that is actually the reason why on a particular screen, when you are observing Young's double slit experiment, though your textbooks will tell you that there is n equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, God knows how much you can do, they will talk about what is the 10th order spectrum, 20th order fringe, but actually what you see is never more than 3 or 4 fringes, and primarily because by the time you go to that distance, the coherence between the two beams has been lost. So, supposing you are doing a white light interference, white light has a maximum sensitivity, eye sensitivity at the middle. Remember that white light consists of red to blue, that or blue to red, 400 nanometer to 700 nanometer thing, and with a maximum eye sensitivity at about 550 nanometer. So the spectral width, which is, this is the central wavelength. So the spectral width on either side is 150 nanometer, and if you calculate using that formula, that lambda square by delta lambda, you notice that coherence length is just about 3 to 4 wavelengths. And this is the maximum number of fringes that we can see on both sides in an interference pattern. And this is what makes the idea of coherence extremely important. Since I will be doing something more today, I will be sort of glossing over this part, but let me also talk about a coherence which is known as the spatial coherence. Now, the spatial coherence is something like this, that supposing I have an extended source, okay. Now, if I have an extended source, it is not a point source, then supposing I have this point P1 and P2. Now, look at path difference that one has to have. If you want to, for example, if you look at the point P2, now there is a path difference of the wave that was emitted from the left hand side of the this extended source over the wave that was emitted from its center, and this is more than this, okay. On the other hand, if you sort of went to the right hand side, then of course this would be less and things like that. So ray from the left edge to P2 travels an extra distance because it is traveling much more, okay. And this, from this point, it travels a shorter distance because every time I am comparing with the path that it is compared with the center. And if you look at the path difference between the two, this corresponds to a phase difference of 2 pi d sin theta over lambda, where this is your d. And if you do that, then we convert this into phase, and so waves which were in phase at the point P1 will be out of phase by the time you go to P2, because there are differences there, and you can calculate, if you put in again the same delta phi equal to 1, you will find out that there is a distance after which the phase coherence is lost. And this distance depends of course on the length of the distance here, delta, which is the size of the source, and wavelength, and there is some constant factor which came from this 2 pi and things like that. So this is called spatial coherence, okay. Having talked about coherence, so let me before I quit this, let me summarize that we are interested in the coherence property of light, that is because the interference, the superposition principle, will give me something different only if I talk about adding light which have coherence between them. So coherence is first thing that I must understand about light. You of course realize immediately, very glibly we say that I have a monochromatic source. A strictly monochromatic source cannot have any, it never goes out of phase, because a strictly monochromatic source, it means it only is giving a single wavelength. We'll come back to it when I have to talk more about it soon. Let me now give you a slight bit of overview about the light, role of light in communication. So far as physics is concerned, we are interested in two of those things, which one of them is, okay, first let me sort of point out that in any communication, your important points are three of them. First thing is, you need a source. You need a source to, you know, generate a signal. So that is number one. Having done that, you need something to carry your signal. I will sort of tell you what those are. And finally, when this signal reaches the other end, you want to reconvert and detect this signal that has come. So I have a transmitter, I have a medium which transmits it, which is usually called in electrical language transmission line, and at the end I have a detector. So these are the major components. There might be many other things, amplifiers, etc., etc., but let us not worry about it. Now, first major advance in the field of communication happened in 1876, Alexander Graham Bell, who, as you know, invented a telephone. Now, what he did is, to start with, because he was interested in the voice communication to be taken from one place to another. So the way he did it is, he had a method of converting the audio signal to electrical pulses at the transmitter end. So his transmitter is basically an audio to electrical converter. Having got the, so audio signal is converted into electrical pulses. Having converted into electrical pulses, he transmits it usually over cables, okay? And then at the end, when you receive that telephone, your instrument has the capability of converting the electrical signal back to the audio signal. And that is how even today, that is the basic principle by which, of course, the technology behind Alexander Graham Bell's telephone has undergone a lot of change, but that is still the basic principle by which we hear a telephone conversation. Now, in order to look at it, let us look at the electromagnetic spectrum. So here, the electromagnetic spectrum is shown some scale. The wavelength is shown here. This is 10 meter, this is in decreasing wavelength I have shown, 10 meter, 1 meter, then 10 centimeter, reducing at equal distances by about 1 tenth, 10 centimeter, 1 centimeter, 1 millimeter, 0.1, 10 then micrometer, 1 micrometer, 0.1 micrometer, etc., etc. The corresponding frequency which is in hertz, the corresponding to 10 meters, it is 30 megahertz, 300 megahertz. Then the name changes, it is 3 gigahertz or gigahertz, whatever you feel like, 30 gigahertz, 300 gigahertz. And again, I have increased it by another 10 to the power 3, so I come to 3 terahertz, 30 terahertz, 300 terahertz, and when I go there, it is called petahertz, which is 10 to the power 15. There are names even that side, but let us not worry about it. Now, if my signal, if I am, when I did communication with in this range, the carrier was a coaxial cable. Now comes some development or where the people were able to increase the frequency. We will talk about why we need to increase the frequency. And when you went to gigahertz, that is your microwave communication. This is what came to be established as standard during the Second World War, and you found that the waveguides were the solutions for that. And today we are talking about a much higher frequency range, and it is in the terahertz or petahertz region, and that is where the optical fiber communication becomes important. So the point is this, that with the increase in demand for communication, our requirement for, now see, the point actually is this: why do we need to increase one frequency after another? That is the question. Well, why can't we still stick to this? Now, the answer to that is the following. See, look at the voice communication in the today or in the old days. Now, in order to transmit your voice, supposing I am one person who is talking about it. Now, you know, I have to convert the audio signal to electrical signal and then transmit it. Now, suppose I needed about 4 kilohertz of bandwidth for the purpose of one communication. Now, there would be, this actually is not good enough because there are other electronics etcetera will be involved, and typically this will be, let us say, about 64 kilohertz after taking care of all losses and things like that. Now, suppose at a time 10 people want to do the communication. Now, then I need a width of 640, otherwise one person's voice will be superposed over the other person's. So, if you want to talk about simultaneous communication, which we are talking about, we have to send them by different channels, because I can't superpose my voice over another person's voice. The other possibility is, of course, from the telephone exchange, everybody has one separate line. Now, that is again not a possible idea, because that is an extremely expensive thing. So, one possibility is that I have a different bandwidth allotted for the different persons, now which requires that I need, supposing I have n number of people, 100 people, I need 6400 kilohertz. Now, so therefore, when I said that we come to the megahertz region, that is the coaxial cable type of communication, I had a certain amount of leeway because my range was still reasonable, and you realize I have already come to megahertz with this 6400 kilohertz. But on the other hand, the total amount of data that can be simultaneously sent over a channel like this is still limited. Now, then came the growth during the Second World War, where, as I said, we went over to screen. So then what we said is that I am here. So, I am in the gigahertz region, and this is, of course, you know, being 10 to the power 6 and things like that, I have a much bigger, megahertz is 10 to the power 6, this is 10 to the power 9. So, I can allot many more channels there. So, I have a wider bandwidth because I can support more channels. Now, our search for communication and the need for sending data, communicating data increases day by day. So, after the microwave communications saw its limit has been reached, then people were looking for that, can we do better. At that stage, the electrical engineers looked at the physics laboratory. I mean, because the question always is, we are discussing physics, why are we talking this? In physics, people have been working with optics, using lenses, prisms, etcetera, for years, much before the subject like electrical engineering started. And this light has a much higher frequency. So, with the increase in the demand for communication, the requirement of the higher bandwidth came, and increase in the bandwidth requires the increase in the communication frequency. Now, this is actually an empirical situation. The empirical situation that is there is that the bandwidth, as you know, what is an empirical relationship? An empirical relationship is something which has been found to be true. I mean, so what is found is that the bandwidth requirement, obviously bandwidth requirement is proportional to the number of simultaneous users. Now, there is an empirical relationship which says that the bandwidth is equal to the central frequency divided by the quality factor of your transmitter. Now, it turns out that the quality factor is roughly independent of frequency, making the bandwidth proportional to the central frequency itself. So, it is because of that, that if I want a bigger bandwidth, I need a bigger central frequency. Now, if I want reliable communication, I need two things. First is, I must have a signal to large signal to noise ratio. It's called SNR by electrical engineers. Signal to noise ratio simply tells you the ratio of the signal power which you have fed to the system divided by the power that is lost due to noise. The noise could be of various varieties, stray noises, white noises and all that. Now, so one of them we already talked about, that I must increase the bandwidth. The other is to increase the strength of the signal, because noise is not strictly in our control. We can do something to reduce noise, but can we increase the power of the signal? So we said that what about microwave communication? See, the microwave communication reached its limit due to an electronic restriction. What happened is soon its wavelength became comparable to the size of the separation between electronic components. And as I said, that if when the communication scientists looked at the physics people, they found an window of opportunity, because physics people were dealing with much higher bandwidths which could be increased by factors of 1000 to 10000 going from the microwave to optical region. So the question is this, that I want a communication. Remember, I told you there are three things there. I need a source, I need a carrier, and I need a receiver. So first question is, are there light sources which could carry information? You would say, what stupid question is this? Because light sources are there everywhere. Sun is a source of light, moon is a source of light in some sense. But we have lights everywhere, incandescent bulb, tube lights, so many things. So we have sources. But the question is, can that light carry information? Now remember, light itself is not information. You don't want to send light from one place to another just for the heck of it. You want to code some information in it. Now how would I code information? Okay, we'll come to that. Second question is that electrical signals were carried by either coaxial cable or waveguides. Is there a medium through which light could be transmitted over long distance? Now, look at the second question. You would say, what is the problem? I mean, I know that if there is light, light after all comes from great distance from sun to coming to this place. Okay? Now, the problem is that I can't have a sun on this place just to carry this. Sun is a very bright source of light. So, the type of sources that I have, let us say an incandescent bulb, a tube light. Now, it may be visible to you through air over, let us say, 10 meters. Sometimes, you know, I mean, if there is no obstruction, maybe over a kilometer, you can see light. But the intensity, it becomes reduced as you go distances, because of, you know, that it goes as inverse square. So, after some distance, the intensity of light essentially becomes so dim that it is of no use at all. Now, coming back to whether the light can be used to store information, the answer is yes. But because what I could do, I could keep on switching the light. Let us say I switch it with certain frequency and decide that this is the way the carry is there. Next question was, if air was not good, you know, physics people have been using the light in the laboratory for transmission, and they use prism lenses and things like that. But the problem is, their distances over which the light is carried in the labs is small. So therefore, they use air. That is, if you are doing a lens experiment in the lab, you are still using air. So the question is that the electrical engineer started asking this question, can we use glass? You know, some or other I can make tubes of glass. Can I transmit it? Now that is where a bigger shock came to our engineers. Okay? That while physics people were restricted to using prisms, lenses over distances which are the laboratory distances, few meters, okay, what we require is to send signals over kilometers, if not thousands of kilometers. Now it turns out that glass is extremely a lossy medium, and typical loss in the glass medium is 1000 dB per kilometer. Now you must, I remind you that the dB is a logarithmic scale. Generally, if 10 dB per kilometer means an attenuation power by a loss of attenuation of power by a factor of 10 in traveling over 1 kilometer, the 20 dB per kilometer means it will lose a factor of 100 because it goes by a logarithmic factor. And so you can see the amount of loss that I will have if I am to talk about 1000 dB per kilometer. It is a hopeless situation. That is, even if we could somehow or other technically mold glass into tubes, I will not be able to use glass as its loss is fantastic. But while people, since people were interested in glass, people were doing experimentation and they found something interesting. They found that the loss that occurs in glass is not intrinsic to glass itself. It is primarily due to the impurities which are embedded inside the glass. Then you would say, then how are the physics people doing it? You see, the physics people were not interested in long distances. They were only interested in short distances within the laboratory. So therefore, if they used ordinary impure glass, they will feel no great loss of intensity. But the moment people realized that glass is not intrinsically impure, but is impure due to the inclusion of impurities there, they immediately got down to doing purification of glass. And what they found is this, two things. These are engineering problems. Two things happened. One is they could find that the glass could be purified, this is primarily chemical engineers and chemists' problem, to bring down the loss to 20 dB per kilometer, which is still pretty bad, which is reduction of power by factor of 100 in traveling over a kilometer, but I will come back to that question. And then engineers were able to have the glass molded into thin fibers, and that is what is known as an optical fiber. So with these two things, that is mechanical ways of engineers and electrical engineers combined doing the optical fiber, and the chemist, chemical engineer, material scientist, physicist all combining to bring down the loss of gas to 20 dB per kilometer, that we have now a basic possibility of a optical communication. Now what about the loss of 20 dB per kilometer? It's pretty large still. But if you look at the loss that one gets in coaxial cables and the waveguides, then you will find this is comparable loss. So in other words, I increase, I do not get much better quality by this, but on the other hand, I use my, increase my channel capacity substantially. Now come to what about a source. Now as I said, that I do not want a steady source. I want to be able to modulate that source. And how is an electromagnetic wave modulated? Electromagnetic wave has three characteristics: amplitude, frequency, and the phase. Now, in order to be able to use light as a means of communication, of coding information, I should be able to switch either the amplitude or the frequency or the phase as a function of time. But problem is, the ordinary light like what we have in our homes, incandescent bulb, you can't switch on at very fast rate. And the reason is, the rate at which you switch, it depends upon your spectral width. Narrower the width, the better is the rate of switching, higher is the rate of switching. And normally, the bulbs that we have at our homes, etc., they are generally wide spectral, they have wide spectral width, so they are not good enough. And that's where laser comes into the picture. Now, my next few minutes, whatever time I have today, I will be talking about lasers. That what is a laser? What is the principle of laser? Okay? Remember, I am a physicist like most of you are. So don't ask me the questions which are more proper for electrical engineers or people who fabricate lasers etc. I'm not capable enough doing it. So let me explain. What is a laser? We'll talk to its principle a little later. A laser, in one word, of course, you will immediately start saying light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. Everybody knows that. But that's not what I'm asking. I'm asking a question as, what is a laser? A laser is basically an optical oscillator. Okay? Now, this is a typical oscillator. Okay? It has an amplitude, it has a time variation, and I keep on having a wave which keeps on. Now, suppose I had an oscillator which could give me this type of a thing, that is a wave which extends from minus infinity to plus infinity, goes on forever. If you do a Fourier transform of this, you find that the corresponding frequency is a sharp single frequency with zero width. In fact, the Fourier transform of this function is just a delta function in frequency domain. So, if I have a continuous wave extending from minus infinity to plus infinity, continuous there in time, then I have a delta function that is a frequency at a particular sharp frequency and with no width at all. But that's of course impractical. I said laser is an optical oscillator. I'm first, let me explain what is an oscillator. So, what we do is this, that okay, what is a typical oscillator? So, normally, however, if I have an oscillator, the oscillator is not this picture that I gave you, beautiful picture which extends forever. So that if I look at it in the frequency domain, it's a sharp line. The oscillator I have in practice are those whose amplitudes keep on reducing. There's a damping effect, and you must have seen this picture of damped harmonic oscillator, where the envelope of that function goes at e to the power minus t by tau. Okay? Now, if you were to look at it in the frequency domain, then you find now it has developed a width. It has developed width because, and which depends upon this gamma factor or factor tau. But before I do tell you what is a laser oscillator, let us look at some of the familiar oscillators that I have got. So, firstly, this is a normal pendulum. I know that I can set it into motion. The time period is given by 2 pi square root of L by G. L is the length, G is the acceleration due to gravity. But the type of, if you leave it like that, it does not give you oscillation forever. It in fact gives you damped harmonic oscillation because of the fact that damping occurs due to many things. One is the air, second one is the reaction at the hinge and things like that. So, the oscillations usually die down, and this is, for example, a one dimensional oscillator, mass spring system, the time period is 2 pi square root of m by k, and same thing, if you let it oscillate, it will damp and go away. An example of an electrical oscillator is an LC circuit, whose time period is 2 pi square root of 1 over LC. Now, the question is this, that how do I go from here, this picture, to this picture? Okay? Because this picture has a wide bandwidth, and I am interested in a bandwidth like this if possible. So, the way to do it would be that as the oscillations are dying down, I must somehow or other supply energy from outside. There is no other alternative. And for example, I could do that in the first two cases by essentially forcing them by mechanical forces from outside, that is provide extra mechanical energy. In the last case, I could simply continue to have oscillations by using an electrical amplifier. But this is roughly what one has to do, that continue to supply energy from outside. So, we need to continuously supply energy. So, my problem, as it seems to a physicist, has now boiled down to two things. I need an oscillator, which I have called as a resonator. I need a method of overcoming the losses, and that is, I need to have forced oscillation maintained. Now, let us look at what happens in case of a laser. The reason I talked about this principle here just now is that the principle of laser is nothing different. Laser is an oscillator, excepting that it is an optical oscillator. And let's see what happens. Now, what the basic idea of laser is this, that I have a two, you know, this picture is very similar to what you get for a stretched string. That's also an oscillation, which I will come back to. So I have a highly polished mirror at one end. I have a partly reflecting mirror at the other end. So that normally what will happen is that, forget about this red pink thing at the moment, that supposing I had a ray of light going there, it would be reflected, coming back, go back, reflected, coming back, and part of it, because it is partly reflecting, will also be transmitted. That will be my output beam. But as I have seen, that I need to continuously supply energy. And that is where I do what is called pumping. I supply energy by, and this energy is supplied to a medium which goes by the name of amplifying medium or a gain medium. So this basically, this along with this pumping process is my method of providing energy when the energy is getting reduced here. So let us look at, you see this picture is the same picture that you must have seen in transverse oscillation of a string, but it is no different. The thing is this, that I am, even in this case I am doing the same thing. I have a transverse electromagnetic wave which is going from one point to another. If you look at that, the way the wavelengths, we know that these form standing wave pattern. So the smallest wavelength that is possible is when one node is here, another node is there, and if the length is L, okay. So basically, if the wavelength is lambda 1, then the wavelength lambda 1 is 2 times the length L, because this is just half a wavelength. And the corresponding frequency is C by 2 L. Now come to this situation, next mode, this mode, this is called fundamental. The first overtone, is when the node is in the middle, there is a node here, so that the length L and the wavelength, in this case I have called it lambda 2, they are equal. The correspondingly, the frequency has doubled. Okay, this is your length L, and the your essentially L is, the total L is lambda. In this case again, I have this one, the correspondingly the frequency is this. So what we are trying to say is this, that supposing I have fixed a length L. Now, I now look at what are the various modes that are being generated. Look at this. This is that, this is that, this is 3 by 2, L is equal to 3 by 2 lambda, and things like that. So suppose I have this type of a situation where I am looking at qth mode. When I say mode, I mean this is your first mode, second mode, third mode, etc. So I am looking at the qth mode, so that my lambda is 2L by Q. Now suppose I take a 1 meter distance between the mirrors and I have a wavelength of 0.5 micrometer, then the corresponding value for Q that I want, okay, you convert that into frequency, it turns out to be 6 into 10 to the power 14 hertz, and I have come to the optical regime. So what we have now decided is that the laser basically requires to have one highly polished mirror, one partly polished mirror, and I need to continuously supply it energy so that it, the oscillations are maintained. And if I can excite a very large number of modes, then I can go to a frequency which is in the optical regime. Now this problem, again is due to Einstein in 1917. He used the concept of, he discussed, this is normally known as the semi-classical theory of radiation by Einstein. The way it works is the following. So look at what he is talking about. So I have given you here the typical atomic levels. I have an energy E1, I have an energy E2, I have an energy E3. Now if I have these three levels, then I know that if I have a population of electrons, for example, in this level, then I can come from here to there. I can come from third level to the first level. I can go from third level to the second level every time emitting energy, and of course the reverse process would be true if I am to absorb energy. Now what Einstein did is to look at what are the possible processes that can happen if I am looking at a equilibrium situation. Now in that context, a factor that is there is known as the Boltzmann factor. Now which tells you that supposing I have two levels of energy U1 and E2 and I am at a temperature T, the equilibrium situation says that the number of electrons that can be in the lower level will be much larger than the number of electrons which are in the higher level, and the ratio is given by the e to the power minus the E2 minus E1 by kT. So in other words, the probability of occupation of a level is given by the Boltzmann factor, which is exponential of minus the energy of the level divided by the Boltzmann factor times the temperature T. This is known as the Boltzmann factor. So this is basic statistics that we are doing. So N2 by N1 is given by this. Now, because of this Boltzmann factor, if I have at any given temperature, the lower energy states are more occupied than the upper energy state. In fact, if you do some calculation, you will realize that, you see, the reason is very simple, that our kT temperature is very small, normal temperature. For example, if you take room temperature, in terms of corresponding energy, the room temperature is just about 1 over 40th of an electron volt, that is 0.025 MeV electron volts. And if the separation between the two levels is, let us suggest, even 1 electron volt, then it means that in order to add thermal equilibrium, one of the levels will be 10 to the power 40 times more occupied than the other. So that is the primary problem, e to the power 40 actually, it does not matter really. Now let us look at what is happening. Now firstly, let us look at what Einstein called as the spontaneous emission probability. Now spontaneous emission happens if there are electrons in the higher level, because they do not like to stay in the higher level, they will always like to come down, because lower the energy, better is the problem. The chances of the electrons being there is better. So Einstein defined a coefficient which he called as A21, it is called Einstein's A coefficient. So the number of spontaneous decays per second is simply proportional to the number of particles in the higher level, nothing else it depends on. So I write down the number of spontaneous decays per second is N2 into A21. So that was spontaneous emission probability. Now there is an induced transition which is possible, okay? That is the transition that takes place in the presence of a radiation. Now in that case, I will still have a transition from 2 to 1, and that transition probability coefficient is called B21, the Einstein's B coefficient. But simultaneously, because the radiation is present, the levels can, the electrons can actually absorb energy from the levels and also go up. So there is an upward mobility probability of 1 from 1 to 2, which is B12, and the transition probability from 2 to 1 is B2 1. There is no great detailed physics being done here. But this number, this is the probability, this number now depends upon not only the number of particles which are in these levels, but also on the energy density which is there. So, which I have written as U nu. So, there is a difference between the spontaneous and the induced. The spontaneous one simply depends upon the number of particles in the higher level, whereas the induced one, they also depend upon the radiation density that is present there. So, what happens is this, that if you have an equilibrium, then the number of upward transition must be equal to the number of downward transition. So, this is from 1 to 2, you remember I wrote down, and this is from 2 to 1. 2 to 1 had two contributions, a spontaneous one and an induced one. So, if these two are to be the same and it is the Boltzmann factor which governs them, you just do that and you find out that the, you know, equate these two and you can get it that I must have a relationship of this type. But you must have also done a Planck's radiation formula. Now, in order that this thing that I have obtained is consistent with the Planck's radiation formula, what is required is that B12 equal to B21, A21 by B21 is equal to this. This factor comes from Planck's radiation formula. And so, therefore, when the atoms are in thermal equilibrium, the ratio of stimulated emission rate to spontaneous rate, okay, B is this. So, this is just your factor by which they take place. So, if you are looking at ordinary optical source in visible region, for example, the spontaneous emission always dominates, okay. And the spontaneous emission is totally random, the source is not coherent. Now, in a laser, what happens is that we build up a certain preferred mode. I will just come back to that question in a moment, because I do not want to do any more mathematics here, okay. And it builds up to a larger value such that the induced transitions become dominant. And this thing, because you have induced it by from outside, the corresponding emitted radiation happens to be highly coherent. And the spectral radiance, irradiance, is much greater than that of ordinary light. And that is my laser. Let us look at what is it that I need in order to have a laser. So, notice one thing. Firstly, the first basic point is Boltzmann distribution. We said that the lower the energy, higher is the probability of occupation. And this curve is an exponential curve. This is the Boltzmann distribution. Now, in order to achieve induced emission or stimulated emission, what I require is there must be more number of particles in the higher energy level than in the lower energy level. This thing is known as population inversion. Population inversion, because normally if you just let a system gravitate towards spontaneity, what it means is there will always be more particles in the lower level than in the upper level, and whenever there are particles promoted to the upper level, they continuously try to come down by emission. Now, the question then is this, that how do I ensure that the number of particles, okay, in the higher level is lower than the number of particle in the lower level? Obviously, it is normally not possible. I want, okay, the rate of downward transition to exceed the rate of upward transition. So, the first principle of a gain medium or amplification is that the light beam will increase in intensity, that is, it will get amplified as it passes through the medium. That is because the stimulated emission exceeds the loss due to absorption. And as we said, that this induced emission happens to be in the same direction as the primary beam and has a definite phase relationship. So this is my situation, that my laser basically is, I have a collection of atoms in this gain medium, molecules and ions in whatever phase, and I have an output, and then EI out is multiplied by a gain factor. I will conclude this with telling you what is the basic principle. Let me look at, okay, firstly let us suppose I have a situation where I have just, you see, atoms have various energy levels, and what makes some of the atoms more suitable to become laser material is there, where are their various energy levels located. Supposing I just had a two level system, forget about this picture, this side of the picture. Now then I have N1 and N2. At a normal temperature, the population in the level N1 is very high and N2 is low. Now what I could do is to say, all right, I want to achieve population inversion. I will pump by supplying energy, electrons from here to there. Now, it goes there, but you see the problem is it will very soon drop down. The moment you stop the pumping, it drops down, because the lifetime in the excited state is much lower than the lifetime in the ground state. It atoms likely to be in the ground state. However, if I had a third level here, then what I could do is, if somehow I could put electrons in this level, now there would be electrons coming back to that level also, but there would be some electrons which are going here also. Now if it turns out that the lifetime here is higher than that in there, which is very common, then there will be build up of electrons in this level. So this comes here, stays there for some time before decay. Now this actually requires a fairly high pumping level, pumping, this is called pumping, pumping power, and that is why a real laser system uses a four level situation. So you have N1, you have an N2, you have an N3, you have an N4. Now these are various lifetimes. You have a T43 is the lifetime of those of transition from here to there, T32 from here to here, T21 from here to there. Now suppose this lifetime is large compared to this lifetime, okay, then a population inversion will occur between 3 and 2, because this is shorter and this will, these two levels will providing the lasing levels. There are many methods of doing excitation, the electron excitation, inelastic atom collision and things like that, but this is the basic principle of laser. That is that two or three things. One is you have an optical cavity. What was the role of the optical cavity? Optical cavity's role was to provide a method of selecting modes. Now see, remember I told you that depending upon what is L, I can have various modes generated there. So let us suppose these are the various modes generated. I have already told you that they are roughly equally spaced. Now what happens is that supposing this represents my loss line, now I will have lasing provided, that is I will have the cavity resonate provided I can overcome these losses, and in order to do that I need a gain medium. Now it turns out that the gain medium has a frequency response. So if for instance my gain spectrum was like this, this is the frequency, then the amount of power that any mode is picking up is still lower than the loss line, and therefore no lasing will occur. On the other hand, suppose I did this, that supposing I had gain medium which is like that, then you notice that I have picked up two modes. And then for these modes, there would be laser action. So, this is the basic principle of laser, and as I said, the there are two basic ideas provided by physics into this. The principle of critical angle, total internal reflection, because of which the optical fiber works, and the second one is the optical oscillators, which is why the source works. Detector is also has some physics in it, but both because of loss of time and less amount of interest in it for physicists, I will not be discussing the source detectors at all. So, since this is the last hour, I will be not in a position to directly answer many questions, but whatever people are asking, please send the questions on the Moodle as you have been doing, and this time I will not be able to spend some time in the morning to reply to those, but I will be replying them on Moodle itself. But let us see a few questions. Techno India, Salt Lake, Kolkata. Yes.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, please go ahead.
Actually, in your slide 28 number slide,
yeah, I know there is a frequency. Yeah, I pointed out there is an arithmetic error in that.
Longitudinal modes.
There is an these are all longitudinal mode. I have illustrated it for stretched string, where the vibration is transverse, you know. So this is not a longitudinal mode really. See, if you take a stretched string, your direction, you see, that is not a.
Actually, for a stretched string.
Yeah.
I want to know that for longitudinal modes, the modes actually depends on the length of the cavity. But for transverse mode, what is the factors?
See, I was illustrating it with a stretched string. I was giving an illustration using a stretched string, in which I can excite transverse modes, because I can pull the string down and the particle's motion is in the transverse direction. And so that is how I showed. Don Bosco.
Sir, I have a couple of questions regarding coherence.
Yes.
Sir, can you please go to slide number 2? So, in the second point, here you have told that they are incoherent if there is a random or changing phase relationship.
Yes.
So my question here is, this changing phase relationship, if it is well defined, do we consider them to be coherent, or does the phase always have to be constant?
Okay. Make the second question, I will answer it together.
So the second question is related to slide number 8. So over here, if you don't mind, can you please elaborate upon the condition for them not being considered coherent? That is, you have said del phi is almost equal to 1. Okay. So, how does this become the condition for not being considered as coherent? Can you please elaborate on that?
Yes. So, coming back to the point is that when I said that there is a phase, you see, we very frequently say phase difference should be constant. But however, supposing the phase difference is well-defined function of time, I will still be able to control that. You see, basically what we are trying to say is this, that if we have two random phases interfering, then when I take a time average, remember my interference term had that E1 dot E2, and I said, well, because of the fact that my detectors have a response, I need time average. Now, if I have random functions, when I multiply them, their time average is obviously equal to 0. Now, if the phase difference is changing, but it is changing in a predictable way, then I will be able to find out what is the contribution to a to the of the interference term. So interference will not be stable, but on the other hand there will be interference which might be pattern may be changing with time, but I will still be able to see an interference. So I will not be equal to I1 plus I2, as long as that the time difference that the interference that I have got, its time average can be calculated and it can be shown to be constant over time. So that is question number one. The second one I told you is an empirical law which the optics people have said, that what should be the phase difference. You know, we said that the phase, they should be in phase. Now, if I have different wavelengths, then I have their wave vectors which is given by 2 pi by lambda 1, 2 pi by lambda 2. Now, the people, you know, we very often need to say that if the phase difference is so much, then I say that the phase coherence is not maintained. I mean, and that is an empirical relationship. So therefore, and that is where they said, supposing the phi between two sources, the phase between two sources differ by, you know, I mean, as much as 1 radian, then you say the phase coherence has been lost. And in fact, that is a decent way to look at it. I am not saying whether it is 1 or 5 or 10, but what we are trying to say is that as you go away on your screen, your difference in the path that increases on the screen, you know, you go to 4th fringe, 5th fringe, your path difference is increasing. Now, the reason why the interference pattern will vanish after you have seen 3 or 4 fringes is primarily because you are probably not seeing the same wave anymore. So, you see, their question of pure monochromaticity does not arise, but if there is a width of your spectrum, you convert that into the frequency domain. In the frequency domain, there is a width, which is essentially C by delta nu. Now, what we are trying to say is this, that since there is no source known which continuously emits the same wave, because if you have a mixture of waves, then of course you have a width. And so that statement that I gave on slide number 8 is actually an empirical relationship, that if that happens, then assume that phase coherence is not there.
The radiation coming from the stimulated emission, why it should have the same phase relationship with the incident radiation? Why the two radiations should have the same phase relationship?
Yes. So the idea is something like this, that the incident radiation is what you are controlling, because that is what is pumped into the system from outside. Okay. Now, that is what is its energy density is responsible for giving you that some things are going up, you know, in the presence of that. So basically, what happens, this is what is found, the actual reasonings are little more difficult to explain, but what was found, or let us say Einstein's theory is a semi-classical theory. So what he assumed is this, that because you are forcing the process, so this radiation that takes place in the presence of a motivating factor depends upon the motivating factor. I mean, as to why exactly it happens, I think there are now theories of laser which try to explain that, but I do not know much about it. Thank you.
Let us stop.
Okay, we will conclude and go over to the next.